Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel, Dr. Barkis Ophthalmology Tutorials. So today we will discuss about the third ametropia, that is astigmatism. So in this video I will be discussing about, first of all, the concept of astigmatism, how it happens, okay? Then the various causes, signs and symptoms, as well as the management and the Sturm's conoid, okay? So without much delay, let's begin our video on astigmatism. So before going to the definition of astigmatism, let's understand how it happens, okay? So if you have seen my previous videos, I have shown the optical diagrams for the myopia as well as the hypermetropia. So what was happening there, the parallel rays of light which were coming from the infinity were getting focused either in front or behind the retina, okay? So they were forming a point image either in front or behind. So why it was forming a point image? So here the anterior surface of the cornea was uniformly spherical. What does it mean? Means if you take any surface, okay, so if you take this as the anterior surface of the cornea, this is the vertical curvature called as vertical meridian, this is the horizontal curvature called as horizontal meridian. So both these curvatures are uniform, means the radius of curvature of both these meridian is uniform. So it was forming a focal point. So let's just dissect this part, that is the refracting surface, and see how these rays behave, okay. So if you just take the anterior surface of the cornea, that is this whole thing which is marked in the yellow is the anterior surface of the cornea. So this green line represents the vertical meridian, that is this is the whole anterior surface of the cornea and this green line is representing the vertical meridian, whereas this pink line is representing the horizontal meridian like this, okay. So hope you got the picture. So this is the anterior surface of the cornea, this green line is representing the vertical meridian and this pink line is representing the horizontal meridian. So when the surface is spherical, these two meridians will meet at a point, okay. So whenever there is refraction which is happening at the vertical meridian, it is forming some point of convergence. Similarly, the horizontal meridian is forming some point of convergence, but both are coinciding, hence they are forming a focal point. This is what happens with the spherical surfaces. Let's see what happens with the cylindrical surface now. So when the anterior surface is not spherical, that is it is cylindrical, means the vertical meridian and the horizontal meridian have different curvature. So then what happens is, see, this is the yellow color is the cornea and this is the vertical meridian again showing the green and horizontal meridian showing the pink. So the rays which are getting refracted from this vertical meridian are getting converged at this point, okay, whereas the rays which are passing through this horizontal meridian are getting converged at this point, okay. So here they are not forming uniform focal point, instead they form a line, because in some meridian rays are still converging and in some meridian rays are still diverging. So it is not forming a focal point, instead it is forming a focal line, okay. So in the cylindrical surfaces, because of variation in the refraction along the meridian, it is forming different focal lines, that is called as the astigmatism, okay. So now we can define the astigmatism. So you can define astigmatism as a state of refractive error where the refraction varies in different meridian, right? So there is varied refraction in the vertical meridian as well as the horizontal meridian. So they will be forming the focal lines instead of focal point. This is the definition of astigmatism. And this astigmatism is broadly classified into the regular astigmatism as well as irregular astigmatism. Regular astigmatism is one where the refraction uniformly changes from one meridian to the other meridian. Whereas in irregular astigmatism, it is very haphazard. So there are multiple meridian and there is multiple refraction which is happening in the irregular surfaces. So let's see in detail the regular astigmatism. So what is regular astigmatism? How we define it? So in the regular astigmatism, we have two principal meridian and the refracting power changes uniformly from one refracting surface to the other refracting surface. Okay, that is called as the regular astigmatism. So what are the causes for this regular astigmatism? Means why there is difference in the curvature of the refracting surface. So the refracting surfaces are like cornea as well as the lens and even the screen which receives the image, that is the retina. So if there is any problem with that also, that can also lead to the regular astigmatism. So coming to the corneal causes, so most commonly if there is any variation in the curvature of the cornea, the cause is usually congenital and this is the more common cause for this regular astigmatism. Then coming to the causes with respect to the lens. So there can be either change in the curvature of the lens by birth only. So they are congenital causes for the lenticular astigmatism. In cases of high degree of lenticonus, there can be regular astigmatism. That is with respect to the curvature of the lens. Okay. And even if there is change in the position of the lens, like the mild tilting following trauma can lead to the regular astigmatism. And even the very refractive index of the lens can also contribute to the astigmatism. Like in case of diabetes mellitus, where the lens will undergo varying degree of sclerosis, so there is change in the refractive index on the mass of the lens. So that can lead to the astigmatism. So if you come to the retina, if there is any mild tilting or oblique placement of the macula, which is a congenital anomaly again, so there can be astigmatism. So these are the causes of regular astigmatism. Coming to the types of regular astigmatism. The first point to call it as a regular astigmatism is there are two principal meridians, right? So depending upon where these two principal meridians lie and what is the angle between these two meridians, this classification is given. Okay, so the first one is with the rule astigmatism. Just remember the mnemonic V for V. So with the rule, so remember vertical meridian is steeper. Okay, so in the with the rule astigmatism, the vertical meridian is steeper than the horizontal meridian. Whereas in case of against the rule, the opposite. So the horizontal meridian is steeper than the vertical meridian. So here what happened with the rule and the against the rule, the two principal meridian were lying either in the 90 degree axis or in the 180 degree axis. Whereas in oblique astigmatism, though the angle formed between these two meridian is 90 degree, they may not be at 180 degree and 90 degree. So they may be at like 45 degrees and 135 degrees. Whereas in case of bioblique astigmatism, there are two principal meridian, but the angle between them is not 90 degree, so it may vary and even the axis will vary. Okay, it may be like the steeper axis at 30 degree and the flatter axis at the horizontal meridian at 90 degree. Okay, so coming to with the rule astigmatism, so as I told the mnemonic B for B, so vertical meridian is steeper than the horizontal meridian. So the vertical meridian has become steeper, means there is myopic change in the vertical meridian. So you have to correct it with the concave lens at 90 degree. Okay, so vertical meridian is steeper, it has formed a myopic surface. So to correct myopia, we use concave lenses. And if the lens has to act in the vertical meridian, it has to be placed in the horizontal meridian, right? So concave lens at 90 degree, or it has to be opposite, that is convex lens at 180 degree. So this is how you neutralize, or this is how you correct the with the rule astigmatism. So this with the rule astigmatism is more common in the younger age group. If you consider children and the young adults, with the rule astigmatism is the more common type. If you remember one entity, you can easily remember the next one, that is against the rule, which is exactly opposite of the with the rule. So let's not go into the detail of that. So these are the four types of astigmatism, like with the rule astigmatism, against the rule astigmatism, oblique astigmatism, and the bioblique astigmatism. And we have one more classification for this astigmatism that depends upon where these focal lines are falling, like whether these two focal lines which I explained just now, that is one focal line formed by the horizontal meridian and the other focal line which is formed by the vertical meridian, where these two lines are falling with respect to retina, that gives the next classification. Okay, so keep it very simple. Okay, so the classification is like simple astigmatism, compound astigmatism, mixed astigmatism. So what happens in the simple astigmatism, this is the retina, so in one meridian the lines are falling on the retina. Okay, so the focal line is formed on the retina, whereas in the other meridian the line is either behind the retina or in front of the retina. Okay, so the focal line formed by one meridian is on the retina and the focal line formed by the other meridian is either in front or behind. So depending upon whether it is in front or behind, it is again classified into simple myopic astigmatism and simple hypermetropic astigmatism. Okay, so hope it is clear. In simple myopic astigmatism, the focal line will fall in front of the retina, whereas in simple hypermetropic, the line will fall behind the retina. Coming to the compound astigmatism, here again, this is the retina. Here, the lines which are formed by both the meridian will either fall in front or will fall behind. Okay, so this is one focal line formed by the vertical meridian and this is one focal line formed by the horizontal meridian. Both are falling in front of the retina, that is called as compound myopic astigmatism. So if both the lines are falling behind the retina, it is called as compound hypermetropic type of astigmatism. Whereas in case of mixed astigmatism, this is the retina. Okay, so the focal line formed by the vertical meridian is in front, whereas the focal line is formed by horizontal is behind. Okay, or vice versa, that is one focal line is in front, one focal line is behind, that is mixed type of astigmatism. So hope it is clear now. Simple astigmatism, compound astigmatism, mixed. In simple again, myopic and hypermetropic. compound again myopic and hypermetropic and mixed. So what is the incidence of this astigmatism? If you consider infants, more than 50% of infants will have very mild degree of astigmatism of less than 1 diopters. And as the child grows, the astigmatism usually decreases. But if you consider the adult population, okay, almost 15% of the adult population will have the astigmatism of more than 1 diopters, whereas 2% of the adult population will have astigmatism of more than 3 diopters. Okay. So if you consider the adult population, most of the people will have very mild degree of astigmatism. Okay. Among all the refractive errors, okay, the astigmatism will contribute up to 60% of the refractive error. So among this 60%, that is if you consider this as 100, then half of the patients will have very mild astigmatism of just 0.25 to 0.5, whereas 25% of the population will have 0.75 to 1 diopters of astigmatism. 24% of population will have 1 to 4 diopters of astigmatism, whereas just 1% of population will have more than 4 diopters of astigmatism. And if you see the incidence depending upon the classification which I told just now, the compound myopic astigmatism is more common, then comes the compound hypermetropic, followed by mixed, simple myopic and simple hypermetropic. If you consider the Witherell astigmatism type of classification, Witherell astigmatism is present in 38% of the astigmatic people. Against is in 30, oblique is in 32%, and bioblique is very less. Okay. Coming to the symptoms of astigmatism. So the first symptom is the blurring of vision, and that depends upon the degree of astigmatism. If the astigmatism is less than 1 diopters, then the patients will have transient blurring of vision. Like whenever they are constantly focusing on some target and doing their work, then they will have transient blurring of vision. At that moment, they will just rub their eyes or close their eyes and it is relieved. Okay. If the astigmatism is more than 1 diopters, the patients will have the constant blurring of vision. Unlike in the spherical errors where the patient was having diminution of vision, here the object itself is like distorted. Like if the patient is looking at a circle and the patient is having pure astigmatism, he may elongated oval. Okay. And if the patient is looking at a point source of light, it may be tailed off like this, depending upon the type of astigmatism. So that's how the patient sees images in case of astigmatism. The next symptom here in astigmatism is the astenopic symptoms. Okay. As you know, the astenopic symptoms are like tiredness of the eyes or the headache. Okay. And when the patient is having astigmatism, the astenopic symptoms are more worse. Okay. Patient can have even dizziness, irritability, and even the fatigue. Okay. So the astenopic symptoms are more common in the astigmatism compared to the spherical error, and the minor degree of astigmatism will lead to more symptoms compared to the higher degree of astigmatism. Okay. And when you consider the type, Witherell astigmatism patients will have more symptoms, but with more symptoms, like because they are trying to accommodate for the astigmatic error, they can have more symptoms. At the same time, the image quality which is formed is better in case of Witherell astigmatism patients, whereas against the rule patients will have less symptoms and the quality of vision is also less. Okay. And whenever the patient is having hypermetropic type of astigmatism, which I described just now, like in case of simple hypermetropic or compound hypermetropic patient, the symptoms are still worse because the patient has to accommodate for both astigmatism as well as the hypermetropia. So the astenopic symptoms will be worse. And you might have seen some people who will watch the TV with head being tilted like this, or even when they are reading, they will tilt their head. Okay. So that is, tilting of head is also a symptom of astigmatism. So by tilting head, the image distortion is decreased. So the quality of vision is improved. So subconsciously, they will tilt their head when they are watching TV or even when they are reading. Okay. Even the squint can appear in astigmatic patients. And the next symptom is half closure of the eyes. Okay. So they will just close their eyes to some extent and try to read, because by doing that, the rays which are coming through one meridian are completely cut off. So the patient has to just focus with the other meridian. So the patient's image quality is good with the half closure of eyes. And as I told, these patients will have astenopic symptoms, and so they will be rubbing their eyes constantly. So there can be falling of eyelashes, or even there can be hyperemia of the lid margin, and even the repeated chalazion can be a manifestation of the astigmatism. So what are the various tests you need to do in case of astigmatism? The first is the refraction. So do both dry and wet refraction and look for the exact power in each horizontal and the vertical meridian. Then the keratometry or even the corneal topography to see for the corneal curvature abnormalities. Then the astigmatic fan test itself needs a separate video. Just remember, astigmatic fan test is also done for the astigmatism, and the Jackson's cross cylinder. So there is a video on Jackson's cross cylinder in my playlist. Please do watch this video on Jackson's cross cylinder. I have given the link in the description box. So these are the various tests done for astigmatism. Coming to treatment of astigmatism, the first is the optical treatment. So whenever you are mentioning about the optical treatment, mention what kind of lens you are using. So here we will be using cylindrical lenses. Okay. So these cylindrical lenses can be used either in form of spectacle. It can be used in hard contact lens form or the toric contact lens form, which is a type of soft contact lens. Okay. And there are some important points which you should remember whenever you are prescribing glasses for astigmatic patients. So the first thing is, if the astigmatism is very mild, say less than just 0.5 diopters of astigmatism, and the patient is not having any asthenopic symptom, don't try to correct the astigmatism. Only if the patient is having asthenopic symptoms and mild astigmatism, you can go ahead with the correction. The next is, when the patient is having high degree of astigmatism, it has to be corrected. But the adult patients may not accept the full correction at once. Okay? First, give lesser amount of correction which the patient will accept. Then you can go on increasing the correction factor. Suppose the patient is using glasses, and in their glasses they have the number at one particular axis. And when you do the refraction in the next sitting, you may find the axis being changed. Then when you are prescribing the new spectacles, you have to be very cautious, because the patients may not adjust to the new axis. So only if there is very gross improvement in the vision with respect to the new axis, you should prescribe the glasses. But you should tell the patient that you may need some time to adjust. Okay. And whenever the patient is having bioblink astigmatism or mixed type of astigmatism or very high degree of astigmatism, go ahead with the contact lens than the spectacles. And if the patient has both spherical error as well as the astigmatic error, then correct the astigmatism as I told, and guidelines for the spherical error I have explained in my previous videos. Okay. So this is how you treat the patients with astigmatism. Next, the optical diagram for this astigmatism, that is the refraction through the toric surface. I've explained in my next video, which explains about the Sturm's cone. Okay. This explains completely about the regular type of astigmatism. Now we will move on to the irregular type of astigmatism. So the next entity is irregular astigmatism. So you saw in the regular astigmatism, there were just two principal meridian. Whereas in the irregular astigmatism, there are multiple principal meridian. Means there is refraction which is occurring to multiple meridian. Okay. And the change in the refraction is not uniform through all the meridian. That is the definition of irregular astigmatism. So what are the causes for irregular astigmatism? It can be either in the cornea, like following trauma, there can be scar formation in the cornea that can lead to irregular type of astigmatism. Even in the lens, because of varied refractive index, there can be irregular astigmatism. And when it comes to retina, if there is some scar in the macula or tumor in the retina, that can lead to irregular astigmatism. In the treatment options, we have the optical treatment and the surgical treatment. The optical treatment, because the cornea, that is the refracting surface, is irregular, you have to replace with a uniform refracting surface, that is contact lens. So you can treat with the contact lenses, or the surgical treatment is the penetrating keratoplasty. So those are the few words about the irregular astigmatism. So hope this video on astigmatism is helpful to all of you. If you like my videos, please do subscribe to my channel. Press the bell icon for further notifications. Please do like and share my videos and leave your valuable comments. Thank you so much.